one thing here. Perfect. Couple questions that came out in the chat box. We will be recording this whole thing. We're not totally sure how we're going to distribute it to the wide world yet, but it will be recorded for later. So if you miss something or if you want to come back and look at it, then we can connect you with that. So we're still running a little low on some of our participants. So maybe we give it another couple minutes, Katie, and see what happens.
Okay, that's fine.
Figure since we have people register, then we could expect that they'll show up. So so maybe they will. I'll give a little introduction to myself, and then you could do that as well, and mm-hmm. your history of making cool paintings like what's in the background there.
That sounds like a plan.
Cool. So hi everyone, my name's Lauren. I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. I manage the volunteer trail adopters and some of our other programs that we do to get people out working on the long trail. I've been with the Green Mountain Club for about 3 years, and I'm really glad to have you all hosted here. I wouldn't call myself an artist, but I do frequently get nice boxes of colored pencils and little sketch pads for Christmas time, and that's what keeps me going. And I'm excited to learn a little bit more here. So that's what I got for you.
Awesome. And Lauren, and everyone out there, anyone that makes art is an artist. So it's not like some exclusive club where you can't call yourself an artist unless you do XYZ. So don't be afraid to call yourself an artist no matter what you make. I guess I'll introduce myself now. Hi, I'm Katie. I was a caretaker at Stratton Pond for the Green Mountain Club last summer, and I'm coming back working for the Green Mountain Club again this summer. I'm very excited for that. I guess my art history is I've been making art for my entire life, basically, and watercolors was kind of one of the first mediums that I was introduced to, and then kind of went away from it throughout school and came back to it in college and really just totally fell in love with the medium again. Which works out great because it's very transportable, so it's easy to take it on the trails with me. I actually just got back just over a month ago from being on the Appalachian Trail, and I had my sketchbook with me down there, painting the views when there were any. It was rainy most of the time, but the few times where it was nice out, I was able to paint. So that's me. That's what I do. I hike and I paint stuff.
Yeah, that seems like a good way to do it. We're super glad to have Katie back this year in an increased capacity, and excited for the time comes to get out and get back on the trail. For any of you out there that are wondering about coronavirus stuff or how it's affecting the long trail, our website has a lot of information on it, and you can get in touch with us through there. We're going to focus on painting here, though. Katie, I think we've steadied at our number, and we can probably get started.
Great.
Maybe, I don't think there's any particular notes with that list of supplies. Is there anything that people should be aware of?
Not particularly. I can go through and just kind of show you all what I'm using, and then, whatever you have is what you have. But if you brought a variety of things, you can kind of adjust your stuff based on what I'm using and what sounds fun, and then we can get going.
Cool. I'm gonna stop the screen share. And that should make all of our faces bigger to people out there. And I believe I've spotlighted your video. So now hopefully that's what everybody is seeing the biggest of. Everyone, if you're seeing the biggest thing as Katie's table right there, then that's how it should be working.
All right. Great. So first of all, the most kind of one of the most important things that I'm using is some paper. So something to paint on. I've got a 9x12 sheet of paper, and I've got it taped down around the edges here. That way, just when I finish my painting, like you can see on this one, it was taped. It's got a really nice clean edge. It's kind of fun to peel it off at the end. And it also holds the paper in place because watercolor is a wet medium, and the paper tends to kind of buckle a little bit as you're painting with it. So I think that having it taped down just helps keep everything kind of neater throughout the painting. I've got paint with me, This is my entire watercolor set. I'm just going to be using orange and darker blue and black. So just those three colors. So if you've got a whole bunch of colors, you can absolutely feel free to use as many as you want to. The first kind of test run I did of this painting, I had pink and yellow in the sunset also, but I decided to just kind of tone it back and keep it simple for this because I believe that we do have a lot of beginners out there. So just kind of the less we've got going on, the kind of simpler it's going to be for everybody. But even though I'm going to be leading you through this step by step, it's your painting or your drawing, your, you know, whatever you're making. So feel free to make it as funky as you want or follow along or ignore me, like whatever you want to do, go for it. I just want to be here making art with you guys. So that's my paint. I've got a cup of water. Since I am using watercolors, I need to be able to rinse out my brushes and use water to kind of move the paint around the paper. So that's a good thing to have. Make sure that you keep your tea mug very far away from your water mug. That happens more often than I'm proud of.
Katie, I forgot to launch the poll, so I'm going to do that as well.
Ooh, yeah, let's do that.
Be kind of fun to see what people have. But you can keep on going, and as people answer in, we'll take a break.
Definitely. I've also got a mixing palette. So this is just kind of the thing that came with the plastic watercolor palette. It's just a piece of plastic that I can mix my colors on. And that's also what this is, but that's a mess. I'm not going to be using that. I'm just using this one here. If you don't have that, that's totally fine. You can use like a plate or something, you know, like a plastic plate, or even just tape down a piece of like plastic wrap or wax paper or something, and that'll work fine. Just something non-porous that you can mix your colors on. I've got a piece of scrap paper so that I can test my colors and just make sure that they're the right saturation before I get on my actual piece of paper here. You know, just so if it's like, whoa, that's way too blue, I'll know on the paper and it won't have, you know, messed up my painting. Not that it would mess it up, but I just like to know before I'm going in. And then I've got three paintbrushes here. So I've got a big brush for my background, because this is going to be just a lot of paint and water all at once. And if I was trying to do that with this tiny little thing, we'd be here for 6 hours. And I'm going to be hungry in the next couple hours. I've got a medium brush. So this is just kind of, you know, medium. I don't take the best care of my brushes, and so the paint always chips off. So I can't tell you what size this is, sorry. But this is what we're gonna be using for the trees and some of the grass down here and the ripples in the water. So just something that's not big, but it's not super tiny will work for that. And if you don't have a medium brush, that's fine. You can get away with just a big and a small one. And then lastly, I've got my little detail brush for painting our little canoer, paddler. I don't know if there's a correct word for that. And our grass. Oh, and I've also got a paper towel just for drying off my brushes, because again, watercolor is a very wet medium and I don't want to completely flood my paper most of the time. So I've got paper towel to kind of blot my brush off whenever I need to.
Wonderful. I'll end this poll and we can all see what people are using out there. Looks like we do have the majority watercolor, a couple people spread out. Way to go, the one person out there with crayons. I love that.
Nice.
And yeah, I think it's nice to have that attitude of, oh, we'll just see what happens and go with it.
Yeah. So I will be instructing this mostly based on watercolor, but since there are a number of you out there using some other things, every so often I'll just throw in like, hey, this is how you could modify it for colored pencils. And with acrylic, you can either water that down and it will work very similar to watercolors, or you can use it at like full strength. And I'll just give you a quick talk through of how to blend the colors in the background. If you are using acrylic, I would make sure that you also have some white paint on hand in addition to the orange and the blue and the black. But for everybody else, you don't need white paint. Yeah, cool. Great. Oh. Shall we get started then, or do you still want to?
No, I think that's great. Yeah, we can cruise on.
All right, super. Okay, so we are going to be starting with the background of our painting. So grab your biggest brush, whichever one that is. And we're going to be using a technique called wet into wet blending. So basically what that means is I'm going to get my paper wet and then put the paint into the water on the paper, and somehow physics and chemistry are going to work so that the paint kind of spreads out through the water. So it's going to be nice and bold right in the middle where we have the most pigment. And then, you know, where there's more water, it's not going to be as bright and bold, and that will get us this lovely kind of fade. So what I'm going to do is just start by getting my brush nice and wet. And for these first few steps, I'm not really going to blot my brush too much. I'm mostly just going to be kind of scraping it off on my mug just to get rid of the extra drippy water. But I do want to make sure that there is still plenty of water in those bristles. So I've got my brush wet, kind of scraping it off a bit. And then what I'm going to do is just get the middle third of my paper nice and wet. So you can start right in the middle. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm just going to go back and forth and kind of pull that water up and then pull it down so that I've just got that middle third nice and wet. And on your own paper, this will be easier to see. It's probably impossible to see on my paper, but that middle third does have a different quality to it. It's shiny now just because there is water there. And if you're not sure how wet your paper is, if it wasn't taped down to the table, you could pick it up and kind of move it around in the light and see where it's wet. You can also just kind of move your head and see where it's wet. And try not to splash water on the finished painting that you have next to you. All right. So once I've got that center of my painting damp, I don't want it like flooded. So if you notice that you have kind of pools of water, what you can do is dry off your brush. And you can use that dried out brush to pick some water back up. Or you can even take your paper towel and just kind of blot at an area if it's looking a little bit too wet. But I'm pretty happy with the dampness of my paper there. All right, now we're gonna add some color. Fun! So again, just making sure that my brush is wet. If you're doing colored pencils, you don't need to get your paper wet because they don't require water. So I've got my brush nice and wet. I'm going right for my orange paint, and I'm gonna just pick up. There we go, so you can see, pick up some pigment. La-di-da-di-da. And so what a lot of artists do is have, like, they'll squeeze their paint right out of their tube as they're using it. And in that case, the paint that you're using is wet, and so you don't need to like work into it as much as I am. But I like to squeeze out a whole bunch at once so that I can just transport my plastic thing instead of a whole bunch of little tubes. So that's why I'm getting a bunch of water in there and really getting that paint up in my bristles. Then I'm just gonna come over to my palette and just kind of make sure that that paint is worked into all of my bristles, and maybe grab a little bit of water and dilute that down. All right, so I've got a bunch of paint in my brush. My paper is hopefully still wet, and I'm gonna go right across the middle of my paper with some orange. Now you can see how that water is already starting to pull the paint side to side or up and down, which is, that's one of my favorite things about watercolor, is that the water, you have to work with the water to make the painting. And I had a teacher in college who called them the watercolor gremlins. And sometimes they work in your favor and sometimes they don't. And you just kind of have to accept what they're gonna do for you. So I've got my nice strong orange right in the middle there. Then what I'm gonna do is rinse out my brush, not entirely, but I'm just gonna give it, you know, kind of a quick swish in the water, blot it a little bit. And now you can see it doesn't have nearly as much paint as it did last time. So then what I'm gonna do is just drag kind of half of my brush in the paint, half of it in that water, and pull it across like that a couple times. And I'll do that on both the top and the bottom, because we want this to be a reflection. So you can see how that's already starting to fade out a little bit. We've got our strong orange, and then it's a little bit less strong. And I'm gonna do that one more time, but this time I'm gonna rinse my brush out pretty thoroughly. So I'm really kind of swirling it around, kind of squishing it against the bottom of the cup a little bit. And then same thing, scrape it off, tap it just a little bit dry. So there's still water in there, but it's not dripping. And again, I'm gonna do kind of just up at the edge of where that color was and go back and forth a couple times. And I'm gonna do the same thing down below. So what this is doing is giving us a really beautiful fade. And I want it to be almost all the way to just, just white paper at the end of my fade, you know, as much as I can, more or less, because orange and blue are complementary colors. So they look beautiful together, but when they mix, they kind of turn into like a weird greenish brown color that you might not want in your sky. So we want to try to have, you know, some whitish paper in between our blue and our orange. All right, so I'll give you all a minute to kind of work on that. I know that I probably paint faster than a lot of you do, just because I have a lot of experience. So if you need me to repeat anything, just shout it out in the chat. Or if you need clarification on anything, let me know.
Katie, you made me remember my color wheel.
Your color wheel?
I'm talking about the mixing of stuff.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, that would be cool to have a color wheel here with me to show you.
All right, I put my screen back away. Bye.
All right. So I'm going to jump right into the next step now, just because we don't want our paint to dry out too much, because then it's not going to blend. So my water at the top and bottom is still wet. It's starting to dry out a little bit. So before I jump into my next color, what I'm going to do is just kind of re-wet those edges with a little bit more water, not a ton, but just to make sure that I've got enough to blend into. Actually, yeah. So once your orange is done, re-wet those edges and then rinse out your brush, clean it off. And then we're gonna kind of repeat that same thing that we did before, except this time with blue. So I'm gonna get my paper nice and damp, starting from the top and kind of pulling down to the orange. And I'm gonna do the same thing on the bottom of that paper. So getting my brush wet, but not soaking, and then coming down from the bottom and working my way up until I hit that, the end of my blend. Nice little poem for you. And I do like to go across, you know, a few times just to really make sure that everything is nice and wet. You'll notice that I haven't gone back in and touched the orange down there, because if I do, then I've got the chance of kind of pulling up some paper, or not paper, pulling up some paint, or kind of making, it's called a bloom when the water sort of moves around and does funky things, which can be a beautiful effect sometimes, but that's not what I'm going for. Yes, you should follow the similar directions if you're using colored pencils. You're going to be starting in the middle. This is an answer to Robin's question in the chat. So you're going to be doing the same thing. You want nice bold color right in the middle with the orange. So with your colored pencils, what I would say is kind of use more pressure in the middle, and then as you're moving up your paper, kind of let up on that pressure so that you get just less saturation with the color. But don't get your paper wet if you're using colored pencils, unless they're watercolor pencils. But if they are watercolor pencils, then put all the pencil on there first and then get it wet afterwards, and that'll blend it around, and that'll be super fun. I hope that answers your question. All right, so moving back to paint, I've got my paper nice and damp, my brush is nice and clean, and now I'm gonna go into my blue. So if you're using colored pencils or acrylics, also pick up your blue. Oh, and for the people that are using acrylics, you're gonna be doing a similar thing, but you want to have some white in between your orange and your blue. So you're gonna do like the middle orange and then paint a stripe of white above and below the orange and kind of blend your orange halfway up into the white, the same way that we're blending our orange up into our clean water. And if you would like more direction on that, just shout it out in the chat, please. All right, so I'm picking up my blue and I'm doing the same thing again. I'm coming back down to my palette just to make sure that it's all worked into those bristles. Da, 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 da. And the blue paint that I have, the pigment doesn't feel quite as strong as the orange, so I like to pick up a whole bunch of it. All right, and we're all worked in, we're nice and bold there. So then I'm gonna go up into the top of my painting and get a nice bright blue stripe And same thing, I'm going to go down to the bottom of my painting and get like a nice strong blue stripe down there. Just making sure that I'm getting in all the edges. Beautiful. You're watering down your acrylic. Okay, then just follow along with my watercolor directions. And that was an answer to Leah and Dawn. Hi. So glad you guys are here.
So glad everyone is out there. Thanks for joining. Katie, mine's looking very beautiful. Thank you.
Oh, good. I'm glad. All right. So then I'm cleaning out my brush, kind of dabbing it a little bit dry. And I'm going to go right along the edge of my blue, kind of working my way down towards the orange until it starts to blend in with that kind of almost white paper in between there. So you can see it's got a little bit of a blend. For me right now, that's more kind of white space in between the colors than I'm super stoked about. So what I'm gonna do is pick up a bunch of water and a little bit more blue and go back in and add some more blue in there. And then rinse out my brush nice and clean and pull that blue down into the orange. All right, and what I'm doing right now is I've actually got my blue wash kind of over my orange a little bit, which I wasn't planning on doing, and that happened. That's art. Things happen. And so I've dried out my brush, and I'm kind of picking up some of that paint and trying to sort of smooth out that blend a little bit. And same thing here, that line is a little stronger than I want, so I'm just going to gently kind of go across it and blend it in a little bit more. There we go. That's better. Okay, and back down to the bottom. So again, I'm just picking up some water on my brush, and I'm just gonna pull that blue paint up every so often, cleaning out my brush again and again, and pulling that blue color up towards the orange. Yeah, so that's got kind of a nice blend going on. So I'm gonna call it good for my background down there. Go ahead and keep working away at it. Something again to keep in mind with watercolor is it doesn't really love when you kind of keep going back into it too much. So once it starts to dry, then you can do more layers on top of it, which we are going to be doing later to get the texture into our water. But once you have a blend that you're relatively happy with, I would call it good and leave it, because the more that you pick away at it, kind of you're going to start pulling pigment up and it's going to be a little bit less even, maybe a little bit blotchy, which can be really great if you want like some more clouds in your sky. You can definitely play with throwing some water in there, but that's not what I'm doing today. So I'm just going to stop there and let it dry for a little while. So how's Wonderful. It going for everybody out there?
Yeah, as you're out there, don't get your computer too painty, but let us know how it's going in the chat box. We'd love to hear what's going on out there.
Definitely.
Katie, I'm using watercolor pencils.
Ooh, awesome.
And it's really quite fun.
Yeah.
Just make all kinds of weird stuff go on.
Definitely. Watercolor pencils are fun. I used to carry those into the woods with me because those are a pretty neat thing to carry around with you. They're fun.
Yeah, and I'm learning a lot. I've never done them watercolor. I've always just used them as a colored pencil, and it's really neat. It looks, I'm getting pretty close to that.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good. I'm happy.
Well, so everyone out there, I guess we can give a little second background to the Green Mountain Club. We maintain the Long Trail and the Appalachian Trail and the Northeast Kingdom Trails in the state of Vermont. The organization was founded in 1910 with the intent of building the Long Trail. And 20 years later, there was a trail that went all the way from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border. Since then, we've been staffing people out there. We've been using volunteers. We've been really preserving and protecting the Long Trail throughout the entire state to allow Vermonters to connect with it. One of the people that did that last year for us was Katie. Maybe now, let's see. What's my second poll, Katie? That could be a good time. Ooh, here we go. What is your answer, Katie?
My answer is going to be Stratton Pond.
Oh, nice. There you go. Thank you, Dana, for taking pictures.
Cindy, yes, that is normal. She says, my paper is securely taped down and still warped. Is that normal? Yes, mine is also buckling a little bit. It's kind of bumping up in the middle. You can't really tell because the video is right overhead. But it is kind of bumping up right in the middle. And that's just, you know, paper getting wet. That's going to happen. If you have like super nice, fancy, expensive paper, that won't happen. But I don't.
You can just use plain old normal paper, huh, Katie?
Absolutely, yes.
Well, thanks y'all for putting in a vote there. We still got a couple people out there, so we'll let it go for a sec. But yeah, that's what the Green Mountain Club does. We are a member organization. There's right under 10,000 members that support the club with an annual fee. But we're supported in many other ways, from individual donations, from business sponsors and business memberships, and from simply our core of over 1,000 annual volunteers. So if you want to get out and help the Long Trail this year, then get in touch with us. If you want to become a member, it's a really great way to support the club. And just coming to things like this, even though they're online and we're all maybe sitting on the couch, it's really great to have you participate in. All right, let's see how our polling went. Sterling Pond,
If you add up the three Stratton Ponds, then Stratton still wins.
Somebody out there made a good point that I may have gave Stratton Pond an unfair advantage. thanks all for participating. We staff caretakers at our ponds from June to October, really popular places down on the Southern Long Trail, which is also the Appalachian Trail. And part of the, you know, I think amazing thing about the Green Mountain Club is the long history that we have at those ponds and the role that we've played in conserving the landscape over the last 100 years so people can go visit them.
Definitely.
You see, you've got an art question, Katie.
Yes, I'm reading it right now, Catherine.
Excellent.
Yes, that makes a lot of sense. Hopefully everybody's reading that because it's a long, long block of text. I definitely agree with you. When you're painting from a picture at home, the picture that you're looking at is in two dimensions. So it's, you know, a lot simpler for your eye to kind of translate where things are on the picture versus where they are on the paper. And then when you're actually out on a mountain or looking at a pond or something, you know, things are moving around and you're seeing it in 3D and trying to translate into 2D. So that can absolutely be challenging. Honestly, I think the biggest thing is just practicing, just going out there and just doing it. The more you do it, the better you're going to get. Another thing that really helps is not having super high expectations for what it's going to look like. Because honestly, sometimes, you know, you go out there and you're like, wow, I nailed that. This is the most beautiful painting I've ever made. And a lot of times you're like, all right, well, I learned something and I'm going to move on from that now. Definitely. I think a couple other things that really help are keeping it simple. So when I'm on top of a summit or something, oh yeah, Cindy, that's a great idea too. So she said to take notes so that you can take your notes back to the studio to finish the art piece. That's an awesome idea too. So you can say like, oh, this is kind of what the weather was like, or there was this many people on the summit that I wanted to paint in, but they were all moving around, or, you know, anything that might be important to what you want to paint. But another thing that I find helpful is keeping it simple. So if I'm looking at a vista and there's like 1,000 trees and mountains, 40 layers of mountains in the distance, if I kind of tone that down and I'm like, all right, that tiny mountain, not important, not going to worry about it. I'm going to do 5 trees so that we get the idea that there's trees there. Or kind of just picking one small part of the vista rather than, you know, trying to paint the entire view from Camel's Hump. If I just say, okay, I'm just going to paint that view. just kind of simplifying it, taking notes, taking pictures of what you're doing also helps. And just having fun with it and having, you know, being gentle with yourself, having lower expectations is really helpful. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, that's awesome. That's good feedback.
Oh, Becky, that's an excellent idea too. Make yourself comfortable outdoors. If you're getting a sunburn and being eaten by bugs, it's not going to be a good experience or a good painting. That is true. So bring your hat, wear your sunscreen, bring some tea with you, whatever you need to do.
Put your bug net on maybe.
Yeah, all of them.
Cool.
Yeah. All right. All right. So my painting is almost dry. I can tell because when I'm looking at it, I'm kind of angling around. I'm not really seeing any super shiny spots anymore. Anywhere that's still shiny is still wet. It's still got water in it. And also, if you don't see shiny spots, but you touch it and the paper still feels kind of like cool and clammy, it's still a little bit wet. So you can just kind of gently touch it with the back of your hand and see like, okay, that's pretty dry. So I am just about dry, just about there. Hopefully the rest of you are also nearing dryness. If you're using colored pencils or crayons, you were dry the whole time. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Just kind of hanging out, waiting.
Yeah. No, that's great.
Yes, you can use a hairdryer. That helps a lot.
Oh, interesting thought. There you go. What about the thing I always see? Can you flap it around a little bit?
You definitely can. So mine's taped down, but I can actually pick up my other piece of paper and just kind of fan it.
Oh, that's smart too.
And that works too. And then you can fan yourself, fan your paper.
So that's a good.
Doing a British Baking Show, like trying to cool off your muffins. I've been watching a lot of the Great British Baking Show.
There you go. There you go. Been watching a lot of Zoom meetings.
That's great.
It is. Yeah. Well, if anyone else out there, you know, if there's things that you're wondering about, or if you're considering getting out to do some work, some artwork yourself, we'll probably be hosting another one of these sometime in the next couple weeks. There's also many other good GMC events coming up. We have trivia on this coming Thursday night. We have an adventuring with babies, toddlers, and preschoolers on Wednesday night. So two of our volunteers that have a little young girl, they're going to talk about what it's like to take your daughter to Morocco or to spend 2 weeks in a tent together. So you should check all those out. All that's on the GMC's website. We'll be doing it through this medium for most of the time, and it'd be great to have you join. Really trying to keep people busy when they're sitting at home doing this stuff. You can see that online.
Steph has a question. My paint sometimes gets crackly both on the page when it dries and in my blending palette. Does that mean cheap paints or too much water? What do you mean by crackly on the page? I think I know what you mean by crackly in the palette, like it just sort of cracks apart as it's drying in your palette. Yeah, it could mean both. Cheap paints, maybe old paints, too. Possibly. It's like tiny bits of pigment come together. Okay, yeah, that's probably just kind of a cheaper paint, a lower quality pigment would be my guess. And I know that there are a few other watercolor painters out there that have a lot of experience. So if you guys have any insight into this question too, feel free to jump on in on that.
Sure.
But as long as you're having fun, it doesn't matter how cheap or expensive your paint is. They're yep. definitely cheap. Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much just it. just the pigments probably aren't ground as finely, and we don't need to go into how paints are made. That's not the point of this thing. But yeah, kind of the more expensive a paint is, the better pigment it has. But all paint works, as long as you're having fun. Okay. Shall we jump back into our painting?
Sounds good to me. I'm ready.
Awesome. Oh, I'm glad that Margot's having fun, and somebody named Alana mentioned a while ago that her 4-year-old daughter was joining in as well. So I love that there's kids and adults and everybody painting. So this is great. All right. So before we get going again, everybody take a look at your paper for now and decide which side you actually want to be your sky and which side you want to be your water. It's basically the same on both the top and the bottom halves. So if there's one side that you feel like the blend turned out a lot smoother, I would make that the sky, the top side, because we're not really doing anything else up in the top here, whereas down in the bottom, we are going to be putting in a lot more stuff. So if there's one half of your painting that you're like, that's a little bit messy or it turned out a little bit funky, that'll be fine to be the water. So just take a second, decide which half you want to be what. I'm just going to leave mine as is. You know what? No, I like this side better for this guy. So I'm going to turn this around. And while it's up, I'll kind of show you. You can see how my paper definitely buckled a little bit as well while that paint was drying. So yeah, so there we go. So that, okay, good. We can all see that. I'm just turning it around, retaping it down. Great. We are done with our big brush, so I'm just going to put mine out of the way just so that I don't, you know, knock my water over and get it all over everything, because that would be super sad. I'm going to be grabbing my medium-sized brush. You're welcome for the tip, Becky. And so same thing to start. I'm going to get that nice and wet and then just kind of scrape it off on the sides. Actually, let's talk about what we're doing first. So we're going to be adding in the ripples down in the lower part of our water. So these are great because they're all kind of different shapes and sizes, but when you look at it from a distance, boom, it looks like water. So that's what we're doing. We're going to start with the blue. So I've got my medium brush, drying that off, and I'm going to grab some more paint and bring it back on over to my palette just so that I've got that kind of refreshed. And then I'm going to add a little bit more water into that, just because I don't want it to be super duper, super saturated. I want it to be a little bit more transparent. So with watercolors, the more water that you add into a color, the more transparent it's going to be. And you can also test that out on your little test sheet of paper and see like, oh yeah, that's a good transparency, a good strength. All right, so I've got my more transparent blue paint on my brush, and then I'm going to come right down into my water. I'm going to start at the bottom because we are going to be painting some grass down at the bottom. So you can kind of practice these marks down here. And if there's any that you don't like, you're going to be putting grass on top of it. So it's kind of great. Layering is awesome. So what I'm going to do is make blob shapes. Basically, by taking my brush, I'm holding it at quite a sharp angle here against my paper, maybe like 40 degrees. I don't know. Math. I do art, not math. I do math too, but mostly art. And then I'm gonna start by using light pressure and kind of just the very end of the brush. And as I drag it across the paper, I'm gonna push down harder on the brush and then pick it right back up again. And so that's gonna give me this lovely sort of blobby shape. Now, I don't want these to just be straight lines right across my paper like that. I'm kind of giving it a little bit of a wiggle sometimes. Every so often, just to kind of make the water look a little bit ripply. And so I'm just going to be going through the whole water area of my paint, or of my painting, and I can have some of these be coming in from the side. That's going to look fun when we take the paint off, or take the tape off. And I'm also going to be really varying the size a lot, so sometimes I'll do just like a very small little bit. Sometimes I'll do one a little bit bigger. I might even connect two together. And they look weird at first, but the more of them that you make, the more like water it's going to look. All right. So I'm just going to go kind of back and forth across my paper and make these lovely watery shapes. Oops. And you can really experiment, maybe do some with the whole thing is just the end of your brush, so it's like a really small little shape. Some can be a lot bigger. And you can also kind of play with how much water you have in that paint, because this first one you can see is a lot more transparent, whereas some of these other ones are drying a bit more saturated, and that's kind of fun to have that variety. This is something that I really love about painting nature, is that it can be a little messy, a little funky, but it still looks like water. And so I'm going to be working my way up, adding these little ripply shapes in here, kind of connecting them, making some little ones, some big ones. And as I work my way up my water, I'm going to start kind of making them smaller. So the ones in this lowest, maybe quarter of the paper, I'm going to keep them kind of nice and big and bulky. And it's like there's some nice, you know, sunshiny little ripples going on in the water. But as I go up the paper, that is the part of the pond that's actually getting further away from me. So it would stand to reason that the ripples are going to look smaller because they are farther away from me. So that's just something to keep in mind. And if you've already gone through and done all your blue ripples all the way up to where you have the orange and they're all huge, awesome. It's a super windy day. Your paddler is just a really, really good canoeist for not tipping the canoe over in that super windy weather.
Katie, I love that you can make up, you know, if it doesn't come out the way that maybe it looked, then you can just make up a story and then it comes out the way that you want it to.
Oh, yeah. Art is great. Mm-hmm. It's your painting. It can be, you know, whatever you want it to be. It's your world, as Bob Ross would say. So I'm still working my way up. And as I'm getting up into this sort of more white area blending in between my orange and blue, I'm just going to add a little bit more water into my blue paint so that it's a little bit less saturated, just because I don't need to have my paint quite as bright blue in this area up through here. So I'm going to start making it a little bit smaller. And even though I'm right-handed, I have this annoying to myself tendency to paint from right to left, so I have to be careful to not smudge what I'm doing. So just kind of be aware of where your hand is in relation to your painting. Working my way up. I'm even getting a little bit of this blue up into my orange. Kind of starting to make these marks a little bit sparser. Not quite as many of them because we're further away. And they're nice and small now. All right. And I'm gonna call that good for my blue. If you want to keep playing with it, you can add some more pigment and you can go back into some of your ripples and maybe add, like, you know, a second ripple within the ripple. That's kind of fun. Get a little shadow effect going on in there. That is not something that you have to do, but if you're like, if you're just whipping through this painting and you're like, I'm done, what's the next step? That's something fun to do. Just add some more pigment into a few of those ripples. Just get a little bit more texture. And if you're still working on the blue, keep going on that. I'm just gonna get folks started on the next step, which is basically the same exact thing, but in orange. So you'll notice here we've got orange ripples kind of coming down from the top half of the water. So that's basically going to be essentially the same thing. So I'm just going to get my orange paint wet again, get some more water into there, test it out on my little test paper over here. Yep, looks good, looks orange. Now just keep in mind that we are going to be making some land halfway across this painting. So just kind of be aware, like, all right, maybe that's about where I want my shoreline to be. So don't do any water ripples above that, because that's the sky and it would be kind of weird if it had ripples up there. So I'm going to start these about where I'm meeting the blue. I'm going to kind of intersperse these within the blue. And we don't need as many orange ripples and we don't want them to be as big, again, just because the orange water is further away from us in space. So it's not going to be quite as bold. But we can go through and make, oh, look at that, I'm painting left to right now. Now that I'm thinking about it. You can add some more ripples in there. And the more variety you put into these ripples, kind of the more natural everything is gonna look. So if you just do like a dotted line across, that's gonna look a little bit unnatural. But if we do like kind of a big one and then a couple little dots, that's gonna look a little bit more natural, a little bit more like there's some weather going on out there. So that's what I'm doing.
Katie, when you made this painting, was there somebody in your canoe, or were you imagining yourself in the canoe? What was going on there?
This painting was actually based off of the picture that's in the Long Trail News. And I believe that it's me in the canoe.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So I painted this at home from a picture.
There you go.
Yes. Although there were a couple times this summer that I made paintings while I was in the canoe, which was pretty fun. Just kind of tied it up to a tree on the shore of the lake that people didn't go to. Painted over there. And that was great because if I needed water, I could just dip right into the pond with my little water cup. Of course, I didn't dip my paintbrush into the pond because that wouldn't be Leave No Trace.
I was waiting for that.
Yeah, no, I would never.
Everyone, there are 7 principles to Leave No Trace, and one of them is maybe that would be dispose of waste properly.
Yeah, I think that counts.
I think that works.
When I would get rid of my paint water, I would walk up away from the pond and scatter it into the woods so that it wasn't contaminating the water source.
Ah, the dispersal method.
Exactly. All right, so I'm also going to be bringing some orange ripples down to start blending into my blue a little bit. So if there's any spaces in between my blue ripples, I can throw some orange ones in there. And that's going to start to look like, you know, those lovely little sun sparkles down in there. You might want to use a little bit more pigment on your brush once you get down into that blue area, just because the orange paint is going to be transparent and you want it to kind of show up against that blue. And stuff like this I find really meditative because there's no right or wrong answer. It's just kind of do it until you like how it looks. Dilution is the solution to pollution. I like that.
That is so right, Anne. That's what it's all about.
And it rhymes too. Beautiful. So every so often, I like to just kind of stop painting and look at what I've done, take a step back. It's a little bit tough when your painting is taped down to your desk, because what I like to do sometimes is pick up my painting and kind of like hold it away from myself at arm's length so I can sort of see what everything looks like from a distance. Because when you're, you know, right close up to your painting, you notice every little thing that maybe you don't love or turned out a little bit weird. But when you are at a proper viewing distance, you know, when you later on are looking at this, or when you have it up in a frame and somebody's looking at it, they're not going to be like this close to your painting, right? They're going to be looking at it from a few feet away. So it is nice to get that distance to see like, oh, okay, that thing that was really bothering me, I can't even see from this distance. And that's also nice too, because you can be like, wow, I have a lot of orange over here and not much over here. I need to kind of even that out. So if you're feeling like you like how your water looks, take a minute and maybe like stand up, take a look down like, oh yeah, that looks good, I like it. Or if you can pick it up and hold it away, or have somebody hold it for you and look at it a few feet away, that's a nice thing to do. Another way you can do that is just take a picture on your phone, because again, that makes it smaller so it looks further away. And you can see what it looks like on your phone screen. But as for mine, I'm pretty happy with how that water looks right now. Got some nice texture and sparkles going on in there. So I'm going to put my brush down and stop before I overdo it. And that's a tough thing with painting sometimes, is to know when something is done, especially something that's kind of as like, I don't know, it's done whenever it's done. You know, there's not a specific, like, you need 15 orange blobs and 32 blue blobs. I definitely have more than that. So it's good that that's not the number that I need. But yeah, it's basically just when you like how it looks, you can put the brush down and call it good. Yep. Let's see. So hopefully this step is going well for everybody out there.
I'm not going to show everyone mine because I'm a little embarrassed and it's okay. But it's, I'm having fun. It's going well.
Good. That's the most important part.
Exactly.
Oh, if you are using colored pencils, basically you're doing the same thing, just kind of getting in there with some harder pressure to do a second layer of color on top of what you already had there before. Yeah, sorry, I forgot to mention that for my colored pencil folks. Hopefully you all figured that out. I'm sure you're all very smart. And for our acrylic painters, you're just doing the same thing. Hopefully your background was dry before you put that second layer on though. Great. Let's see, so yeah, I'll give everybody another minute or so to kind of finish up on your blobs and then we'll move on to our silhouettes so that this isn't such a, it's beautiful now. It's a funky abstract painting, but we'll make it a little bit less abstract.
Mm-hmm. The word blobs works very well there.
Mm-hmm. That's a big secret of painting is most of things are just blobs. Different configurations.
Katie, is that the full kit that you would bring out when you were caretaking?
Some of it, yes. I would bring this watercolor palette out with me. I would pack that into the woods every week and then bring it back home.
Mm-hmm.
And I would bring, you know, I'm pretty sure this brush went out with me and some other ones like this. So yeah, this is a pretty similar to setup to what I had when I was living at Stratton Pond. It's different from what I had when I was backpacking, which actually I can show you my backpacking setup if you're all interested in that. Oh, yes, Cindy, awesome question. She says, can you use Pigma Micron pens for detail once the paint is dry? Yes, you can. That's something that I do a lot of the time on a lot of my paintings. So good question. And it's a lot of fun to really add in like super tiny sharp details with pens.
Huh, cool.
Yeah. All right. You know, I'm going to hold off on showing you the backpacking kit because I think that it's...
Yeah,
she's going on the next step.
Yeah.
Good. Okay, great. So we're going to be doing our land and our reflection back here first. So I'm going to be using my medium-sized brush again, and it's all black paint from here on out. So what I want everybody to do is take a big, deep breath. We're going to be painting a big black line right across our painting. So don't worry about it. It'll be fine. Because this is the shoreline of a pond. So it's not, if it's not perfectly straight, that's okay. It's the shoreline of a pond. It's not, nobody went out there with like a ruler and a level and made it perfectly straight. The beavers don't care if it's perfectly straight. So I've got my brush wet. I'm going into my black paint, picking up a whole bunch of that. And then I'm going to decide where I want my shoreline to be. So I want it to be, you know, kind of right there, I think is going to be good. So what I'm going to do is take a deep breath and paint this line all in one go. If you kind of sketch out a line across the painting, it's going to be a lot messier than if you just kind of do it all at one go. So here we go. That's where I want my line to be. And I'm just going to straight across. And it's a little bit uneven over there, but that's fine because I'm going to be putting a reflection down there anyway. So not a problem. I'm going to pick up some more paint and I'm going to start with the top half of my land and my trees just because, you know, I don't want to smudge what I'm doing further down while I'm working up on the top. So what I'm going to be doing to create my trees is, like Lauren and I were talking about, I'm just going to be making blobs. So I'm going to make some small blobs kind of right in the center of the painting, or right in the center of this line here, to make these like little distant trees. So I'm just going to make kind of a blobby little line. I'm basically just sort of tapping and smudging my brush against the paper using just that very, very sharp tip of my brush. And that's going to create that kind of uneven blobby line. Hopefully that you can see that okay. Now it's a little bit far away from the camera. I'll pick this up. So is that, yeah. So you can see how that line on this painting is not very even. It's kind of bumpy and blobby. And then all I'm going to do from this kind of central area is I'm going to work my way up, still doing that same kind of blobby, bumpy line, down, up, making this look like a tree line. And I actually want that to be a little bit higher. So I want this angle to be a smidge steeper. So I'm just going to go up above this again and kind of make everything a little bit higher. And now kind of the bumpier and messier that you make that line, the more like a tree line it's going to look, right? If we just have, you know, say that that's our shoreline and we just have like this going up, you know, that looks like a nice distant mountain, but I want to give it texture because the trees at Stratton Pond are not that far away. So if I make it kind of funky and bumpy like that, that looks a lot more like trees. So I'm going to do that both ways on both sides. So same thing over here. And it does not have to be perfectly symmetrical. You know, maybe one side goes up a little bit higher than the other. Yeah. But basically, I'm just sort of tapping and smudging my brush to make that kind of funky line. And then once I've got that funky line made, I'm just going to pick up plenty of paint and just fill in. Basically, I'm just coloring right now, just coloring in that area in between my tree line and my shoreline.
Katie, this was my favorite part. I was so excited just to get the color.
Coloring is super fun. I haven't colored in a long time, but then I did some the other day and was like, oh, this is really nice.
Well, like you said, you're doing it right now.
I know. Please. Just getting that shape sorted out and then just filling it right in. No stress on this part. Boom, there we go. And then look at that, those are trees on the other side of a pond. I am making sure that my brush is pretty saturated with paint just so that I do get a nice strong pigment with the black, because if you have a lot of water in there, then the orange background is going to kind of shine through a little bit, which can also be cool because it can look like texture on the trees in the background. But I like to have it nice and strong. Let's see. Mary says, would you suggest vertical coloring with colored pencils for the trees? Yes. Yep. I think that'll work out best if you kind of go this way with your colored pencils. And another fun thing that you could do with colored pencils is it's a technique called scrumbling, which I think is just the best word ever. And let's see, I have a pencil over here. So it's basically just kind of moving, here, I'll get that out of the way there. Moving your pencil around. Can you see that? There we go. Moving your pencil around in just kind of a funky pattern, just sort of basically just scribbling. And that's gonna take a little bit longer than just vertical kind of up and down coloring, but that's gonna give you a really nice sort of tree texture. So you can do maybe a combination of that depending on time. You can kind of color it in first with the vertical strokes and then scrumble over top of it to give it some fun texture. Alrighty. Now, once I've got my tree line done, I'm going to go straight down into my reflection. And I want the edge of my reflection to look a little bit different than the edge of my trees, just because this is down here in the water. So this is going to be a little bit of a finer, technique. I still want to have the reflection kind of mirror basically what I did up here, but you don't have to like measure it out and have it be exact as long as it's more or less. I'm going to start with this little shine of water at the very far end of the pond. So I'm just going to go maybe a third of the way across my trees, start here, and then just kind of draw a line and leave a little bit of orange space until I'm about two-thirds of the way across. And so that's just that last little bit of water way at the far end of the pond that's catching a little bit of light as the sun goes down. Then I'm gonna pick up some more water. I like to just start in the middle again so I know where my shortest area is, and use just the tip of the brush. You could actually turn your paper, flip your paper around if you wanna do that. That might be a little bit easier too, just so that you're not kind of painting towards yourself. But I'm just gonna take the tip of my brush and just kind of pull towards me. And I'm making these nice little tiny strokes just with the tip of my brush. And so it's giving me still that nice, uneven, kind of bumpy look for the edge of my trees, but it's just a little bit of a different style than what I did up in my trees up here. And then I'm gonna do that same thing. So I'm just pulling, can you guys see that? I'm gonna try to get around here somehow.
I can see, Katie, that's
okay.
Working.
Okay, do like this. So I'm just taking the tip of my brush and kind of pulling down towards myself, just straight down. And again, I'm making it nice and uneven, but it's just giving me a little bit of a different technique, a different style to play with for the reflection. And so I'm going down all the way across. And I'm just kind of going up and down. So it's sort of like a very distant, like little EKG, sort of zigzaggy kind of thing. And I'm gonna do that on both sides. And then same thing as before, just color it right in with my black paint. And I think that makes it look more kind of watery down there. If you really like the technique that we did in the trees up here, go ahead and do that. There's nothing wrong with that. Either way, it's gonna look like a reflection in the water. I just think it's fun to have a couple different techniques going on. So again, I'm gonna do that same thing down on this side. Again, just using the tip of that brush. If you're having a hard time getting a nice line with your medium brush, you can absolutely go ahead and switch down to your small brush just to kind of make this line. That's gonna give you some finer, it's a smaller brush, it's got a finer point on it. And that might just give you a cleaner edge if that's what you're looking for. So again, just kind of making it funky. And then coloring in. So there we go, that's my trees and my reflection of my trees. And again, what you can do is kind of do it and then take a look at it and be like, oh, okay, this looks a little bit even, especially compared to the trees I had over here. So I'm gonna go back in and kind of bump up a couple of these reflections a little bit more, just to make it a little bit more uneven and funky. A little bit more natural that way, I think. Cool. All right, and I'll give everybody a minute to finish up on that. And then next we're gonna make our little canoeist, canoer, paddler. Does anyone know the correct word for that person in the canoe?
Paddler, canoeist, interchangeable.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
I really like on that, Katie, the particular curve you've got in the front of the canoe, in the bow.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, Becky agrees. Canoeist works.
Right. Okay.
So all you out there, we'd love to see what you're doing. I don't know if you can't add in photos to the chat, but I'm going to put my my Green Mountain Club email in there, and please take a picture and send me an email. It'd be great to see what everybody's working on. We can post it on social media. You'll be able to see what everybody else created as well. We'd love to see those.
Yeah, that would be so awesome. I totally agree. The painting classes that I've taught before, I've been there with the people painting, and so I could see what everybody was doing and like talk to people. So this is a little different than that, but I agree with Lauren. I would love to see what you guys are doing.
Totally.
Yeah. All right. I'm going to get going on my little paddler canoeist over here. So in the picture in the Long Trail News, it is a picture of me. So if you want to say that you're painting me, that's fine. You can imagine that it's you. You can just imagine that it's a ghost canoeing off into the sunset, whatever works for you. So I'm switching over to my smaller brush, and I'm just going to be using black paint. Let's see. So that's all right. I'm going to be painting it on here. Let me know if that's too small, and I'll grab another piece of paper and paint it like enormous so that you guys can see what's going on. But we'll just try it this way first. So just like with any of my other brushes, getting it wet first, getting into that black paint. And if you are feeling a little bit intimidated by painting a person in the middle of your painting, that's what we've got our scrap paper for. Go ahead and do a little practice canoeer. I can even walk you guys through this twice for the people that want to practice it first and then want to try it again. And if you are just like, no way, Katie, I do not want to do that, that's fine. It's your painting. You don't have to put a canoeer in there. You can paint a loon. You can paint a sea monster. You can paint nothing. You can paint a red eft that jumps up out of the water and attacks you if you're littering. You know, any of those things is absolutely fine to paint. But I'm going to be painting a canoeer. So to start out with, I'm going to paint the head. The head is just a little blob. To start out with, decide where you want it. So I want mine kind of right up here, kind of in the farthest point away from me over here. So I'm going to start with my black paint, my tiny brush, and I'm just going to paint a little dot for the head. So a little dot. There we go. That's it, the head. That's all we've done so far. Nothing too scary yet. And that head is not perfectly round. That's okay. It's tiny. No one's going to be able to tell when it's far away. Or maybe I have a funky hairdo going on or something. Okay, great. I'm guessing we've all got our dot painted. What we're going to do next is draw just a straight line across for the shoulders. So right below the head, touching the head, just a little bit on either side, I've just got a straight line. Great. Then I'm going to turn this straight line into a box. So I'm just going to come down on either side, maybe angle it in just a little bit, but you don't really have to. And now this square is actually the life jacket, so we don't really need to round out our shoulders because the life jacket is kind of angular like that. Or PFD if you want to be super technical with it. Whatever you want to call it. All right. Now what I'm going to do is go up and do the hand and the arm next, just so we're kind of working our way down our little canoeer here. So I want the hand to be kind of just up and to the left of my shoulder, pretty much even with like where the eyes would be on this head. So maybe right in the middle of the head. So, and that's just going to be another small dot. Mine's kind of like a little bit of an oblong oval. But if it's just one little blob, that's totally fine too. You don't need to draw or paint all the fingers. This is just, you know, it's very far away. We don't need the details. All right, next we're gonna do the arm. So the arm is, the elbow is basically even with the shoulder here. So just keep that in mind as we're drawing the forearm. So that's gonna come down, angling to the left from that hand. And I'm gonna stop when I get about even with the shoulder there. Just like that. And you might even want to do it a little bit less of a sharp angle than that, but we can work with that. And then I'm gonna connect my elbow to my shoulder, just with another line like that. Oops. So look at that. We've got a nice little elbow. Now on mine, the elbow's looking a little bit round. It looks a little bit like an elbow macaroni noodle. So I'm just going to sharpen up my elbow a tiny bit. This is probably not something that shows up from far away, but I know about it. So there we go. Okay. So I just sharpened up my elbow a little bit. Super. Then I'm just going to draw the canoe paddle. So that's just going to be a line from my hand kind of across my shoulder. And now the paddle's on the other side of the paddler. So we don't need to worry about like the actual blade part of the paddle. So all I'm going to do is just with very, very light pressure and the very tip of that brush, paint a line kind of angling down towards the shoulder. Boom, there it is. That's the whole canoe paddle. And I don't love how the hand looks, so I'm just going to add a little bit more over here to it. There we go. So right now my person's kind of looking like Popeye. That's a pretty pretty burly arm, but once I get the rest of the body in there, I can kind of readjust the proportions and make it look a little bit more proportional.
That canoeist has spent a lot of time canoeing. Got the Popeye arm.
Yes, they're very strong. All they do is paddle back and forth across the pond all day.
And compost waste.
Yes, that we can talk about that. I know my mom's really excited to hear about it. Alrighty. So I've got my upper body done, and we're going to go down working into the lower body. So first I'm going to paint my leg. So this is just going to be a line that goes across, maybe out to the elbow, maybe not quite that far, but pretty much just straight across at a 90 degree angle from the edge of my torso, my little person's torso. Awesome. Then I'm going to make a little curve right on the end of that for my knee. So just like a letter C basically on the end of that line. That's all it is. Now we've got a knee. And whenever you need to pick up more paint, composting is where all the conversations end up. It's true, Becky. And we love it. All right, then we're going to do the rest of our lower body down here. So that's basically, so the life jacket kind of sticks out a little bit from our person's body. So we're going to kind of come in just a tiny bit to the left and then down. So basically just evening up, you know, our knee and our little butt there. Cool. And if you want to color in your little paddler now, you can, or you can do it all at the end. I'm going to fill mine in at the end just so that if you want to take a look at these lines again, you can see them just kind of where I was painting. All right. So that's the whole body of the person. Looking at it, the armpit is a little bit kind of pointy and sharp. So I'm just going to do like a little curve just to kind of smooth that out and make it a little bit more natural, because people don't usually have armpits that like point right up into their bodies. That would be probably something's wrong. And if your body looks like that, I'm sorry. I'm not meaning to insult anyone's funky armpits. All right, onto the canoe. So I'm gonna start with the front of the canoe here. And basically it's just gonna be like a little candy cane shape, maybe even with somewhere on my torso, and maybe a quarter of an inch or so out from my knee. So I hope that all of those measurements are helpful. If not, just kind of go with your heart. So I'm going to start it over here and do sort of a nice little curve and then a straight line into my knee. And so yeah, that's maybe a little bit of an aggressive curve for my canoe, but I think it looks cool. Then I'm going to do something very similar for the back of the canoe. I don't want this to curve up quite as much, and it's not going to go quite as far, but I'm basically starting from the butt and just kind of going out and finishing with a little curve. So that one kind of looks like a ski. Actually, they kind of both look like skis. Then I'm going to go back to the front of my canoe and kind of mirror that shape, but make it come out a little bit further. So I'm starting at the top of that canoe, I'm drawing a nice little curve out. So that's basically like a little crescent moon kind of shape. And then I'm going to go to the back of my canoe, do the same thing, and I want them to end up on more or less the same level. All right, so I'm coming down here and curve down just like that. Then I'm going to connect those two lines with a straight line. And very similar to our shoreline, I find that that for me works better if I just go for it and do it all in one go rather than sketching it in, and then it looks smoother. All right. Well, look at that, you guys. You just painted a person in a canoe. Nice job. Or drew one, whatever medium you're using. Yeah. So you can go ahead and color yours in whenever it's done. I'm going to color mine in now, unless anybody needs the lines left there any longer. Okay. So again, this is just black paint, just filling it in. Cool. Yeah. It's my little person in a canoe. All right, and what we're going to do next is the reflection of the person in the canoe. Now, if you're like, all right, Katie, I was following along, I did the person in the canoe, that was fine, I cannot handle a reflection. Don't do the reflection, it's your painting. But what I'm going to do for the reflection is something very, very similar to what we did for the water. It's basically just going to be blobs, just little black blobs in the water, kind of mirroring the shape of the canoeist. And as I'm looking at it, my head looks a little bit small, so I'm just going to make that there we go, that's so much better. Make that a little bigger. And then I'm just going to take the tip of that brush and underneath the canoe, just paint some nice little uneven blobs. Just like that. Still leaving some orange space in between, so it's like, you know, getting those nice little sparkles. And I'm gonna try to kind of mirror the shape of the canoe. So out in the front, you know, it's gonna go out a little bit further. And I'm trying to vary the shape and size of these little sparkles, these little blobs. And that's about as big as the canoe is. And then I'm gonna just super roughly be like, all right, my person's about here. And so just kind of very roughly recreate the shape of my person, maybe their arm a little bit. All right. Thanks so much for coming, Amy. We'll see you next time. All right. So that's my little reflection there. And the same thing with this, it is easy to keep going back in and like working at it and playing with it. But sometimes it's better to just be like, yep, that's good enough, and put the brush down. All right. Now, would anyone like me to go over the shapes that I did for the canoer real quick? Just go ahead and type it in the chat box if you want me to go over that again. And if not, we are going to get going on the grass in a minute or two.
Katie, I hadn't even noticed the shadow before, but now that I'm like really looking at it, it makes a difference when you look at it in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. It's a small thing, but it kind of brings your painting to the next level.
And same thing with the shadow of the tree line as well. Yeah. And then the little tiny sparkle of pond that is still remaining.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. That's just something that living at the pond, I would notice, like, you know, there'd be the silhouette of the reflection, and then just at the very end of the pond, just that little sparkle. Keegan would like a quick close-up of all the shapes. Yes, we can do that, Keegan.
Excellent. Thank you, Keegan.
Yeah, so this is just a scrap paper, so don't worry about the funky colors on the back. But hopefully this will be easier for you to see. So we started out with our head, which was just a circle. And now on your painting, really all you need to do is like a little blob with the tip of the brush for the head. But since I'm doing this kind of big, that's how I'm gonna do it. All right, and then we had our shoulders, which was just a line straight across below our head. And then to make our torso, just some lines down like that. And then we went up to our hand, which was about eye level and a little bit up from the left shoulder. And so that's just kind of a blob, hopefully smaller than the head. And then for our arm, our forearm is just going to angle, maybe not that much, out to the left. Wow, we've got some weird muscles going on here. Out to the left, and then our elbow is going to connect into our shoulder like that. This person's really Popeye. Fun. Hopefully your forearm and your shoulder are more even than that. But basically you want the elbow and the shoulder to be about level with each other on your tiny person. Then we did our thigh, which is just going to come out from that lower left corner about even with the elbow. And then we've got a knee, which is just kind of a curve on the end of that thigh. And then just kind of paint our little butt there at the bottom of the life jacket. And so that's basically the shape of the person. And then the canoe is just kind of a curve into a straight line. Oops, hopefully more even with your canoer. There we go. In the front. And then off the back, not quite as far, with a little bit less of a curve up. And then same thing in the front, we kind of mirror that shape, come down like that. And a nice curve in the back as well. And then connect those with a straight line. All right, so that's a terribly messy, but much bigger representation of what you want your canoer to look like. And then you color it in and it looks better. And you make their forearm and bicep maybe more even. There we go. Oh, now we've got a huge shoulder. Okay. Oh, and you also paint the paddle in there, which is just kind of a straight line angling back towards the right from the hand. All right. I will leave that just kind of on my palette over here so that you guys can take a look at that if you need to. But unless you had anything to add, Lauren, I think we can get down into the grass.
No, I think that's great. Thanks for doing that little close-up.
Yeah, of course. All right. So for the grass, I'm going to move back to my medium-sized brush to start with, and then we'll move into the small brush. So if you're looking at those grass shapes and starting to panic, we're going to use the little brush to make the actual grass. But I'm going to take my medium brush, load it up with my black paint, and I'm going to come down to the bottom of my painting and kind of decide where I want my shoreline on this side to be. If there's a blob that you were practicing and you made it and you're like, wow, that's the worst blob anyone has ever painted in the history of painting, paint your shoreline over the blob. That's totally fine. This is basically just going to be maybe an inch or so up on either side, which is about 2 centimeters and change for my international folks. And all I'm going to do is start from the left and go to the right, but if you're left-handed, maybe go the other way. That might be easier. And just kind of make like sort of a nice little blobby line that's a little bit higher on both ends and a little bit lower in the bottom, just to kind of recreate that like bowl shape of the edge of a pond. But if it doesn't look exactly like that, that's totally fine. But that's just my rough outline for my shoreline shape. Then all I'm going to do is go back in and color everything below that. So nice and simple, we're just coloring. Just filling this all in with our nice black paint. Or black acrylic or black colored pencil, whatever you've got going on. He's wonderful too. So I don't know if you guys can, probably you can't see it, but I'm noticing some blue kind of shining through my my black paint in a couple places, just very lightly. That's just because there's kind of a lot of water in my brush right now and not as much pigment. So I'm just gonna pick up a little bit more pigment and try to just get some more of that stronger black color down in there. And if you're noticing that your black is kind of transparent, you know, get rid of some of that water, pick up more pigment, go over it again. Another thing that you can do is just let it dry for now and then go back over again with another layer later. That sometimes works better too. Because if you keep adding pigment and water in, then everything's going to start to mush together and it's going to buckle and get kind of weird. So sometimes it's better to just let it dry and do another layer later on, because it's just black, so you can put as many layers down there as you want to. And it shouldn't be too weird. So once I've got my shoreline painted in there, I'm gonna do my grass. So let's see. Luckily, I keep lots of these scrap papers handy. So I'll give you a quick demo with a bigger brush closer up of what grass should look like. So say that's like my shoreline there. So basically to make grass, you're gonna be using your small brush, but I'm using my big one just to show you. I'm gonna start within my shoreline. So not like, not out here. I want it, you know, somewhere within my shoreline. And all I'm gonna do is drag my brush out and kind of give it a little flick at the end. And that's gonna give me that lovely grass blade shape. It's gonna be nice and sharp at the end. And basically all I'm gonna do is go all along the shoreline and fill in my entire shoreline. So I don't wanna see any of that straight line. I don't wanna do like grass here, grass here, grass here, because that doesn't look very natural, right? I wanted to have a bunch of grass kind of all smushing together, covering up that straight edge. And all of my grasses are kind of going the same way, so I can flick them the other way and make it funky and fun. All right, so I'll leave that little demo up there too for you. And I'm gonna take my small brush and my black paint, which I'm starting to run out of, but this is the last step, so that's okay. And I'm just gonna go all along my shoreline and make my lovely little flicks for my grass. Now, this is a backcountry pond. We don't have any lawnmowers out at Stratton Pond, so it's nice to kind of vary the size and shape of your grass, because there's different kinds of plants out there. You know, the grass doesn't get mowed. It just kind of gets trampled down by hikers a little bit, or a lot sometimes, which brings up some leave no trace considerations. Maybe don't trample the grass, stay on trail, please. Thank you. But yeah, I'm just going back and forth with my grass, giving myself a bunch of different directions that it's going, different lengths of grass. And this is another thing, kind of like the blobs, it can be really meditative. You just kind of work your way across, like, oh yeah, look at that grass. Look at this big old clump. That's some healthy grass there. Maybe in the middle, your grass gets a little bit shorter because that's where people are stepping on it to jump into the pond. Maybe that's where the canoe's getting dragged through. I don't know. That's the great thing about making your own art, is you can make up a whole story to kind of explain anything, whether or not it was an intentional thing that you did. So I'm just working my way through. Again, just using the very tip of my brush, fairly light pressure, and just kind of flicking upwards from that shoreline, trying to cover up as much of that straight line as I can. And if you're going along and you're like, yeah, that's fine, but I'm kind of getting bored with these same exact grass shapes over and over, you can turn some of them into some funky plants by using our friend the blob. So maybe these little guys over here, maybe they have some funky flowers on them. So all I'm going to do for that is maybe just paint a couple little blobs out on the ends of my grasses. They don't even have to necessarily touch the grass. And then it sort of looks like a flower. So I don't know how well you can see that from all the way down here, But basically I've got some grass here, and then I can take my brush and just make a couple little blobs on the end, and it looks like some sort of plant. And again, it can be whatever plant you want it to be. It can be, maybe they're raspberries, maybe there's some sort of flower. I don't have my field guide with me right now, otherwise I would look through and tell you names of waterside plants.
We could say that with a caretaker at Stratton Pond, they'll be very vigorous and healthy plants.
Yes, definitely. Whatever kind they are, they're doing well.
I'm enjoying this part. I'm adding all kinds of stuff.
Good, yeah. If you want to make like a little bush or something, like at Stratton Pond over on this side of the pond, there is some shrubbery that actually one morning I saw a beaver like hanging out in the shrubbery, eating all the little leaves and sticks and stuff, and that was just delightful. So if you do want to make some shrubbery over here in the corner, again, that's just blobs. So I'm just going to use kind of the edge of my brush and basically just make a series of blobs. Some of them are going to be bigger, some are not going to be as big. And I can kind of create some little blobby branches. But yeah, that's all that is. It's just a bunch of kind of different sized blobs. You can kind of move your brush around to get some different shapes and angles. And just like with all the other steps of our painting, once you've gotten all the way across, take a step back, take a second look at it. You know, I'm looking at this and my grass is all kind of a similar height. So I'm going to go through and kind of increase the height of maybe the stuff on the side, just because that's not, you know, getting trampled quite as much as the stuff in the middle. All the humans going for a swim and all the beavers eating the bushes. And you can even have some grass coming out of the edge over here. So this actually isn't necessarily touching the shoreline. It's kind of coming out on the side. So that's just, you know, more grass from further away or from further out. Add some more little dots to some of these. A whole little field of flowers down here in the middle. All right, and that's it. Once you've finished with your grass, once you've made any adjustments that you want to, that's pretty much it. Your painting is done. The last step before you are completely finished is to sign your painting, because we all went through and made paintings that probably look somewhat similar. So you want to make sure that yours really stands out. So you can sign your painting. If you have like a white gel pen or something, or a silver Sharpie, you can sign in the black area. That would look super cool. I don't have one with me right now, so I'm just going to use my brush. And I like to just sign my initials in one of the lower corners of my painting, just like that, and it's done. Hooray!
Wow. Cool. That was wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
And all you out there, let us know how things are going in the chat if you'd like to. If you've finished up, then please do take a picture and send it off to that email in there. Seems like everyone's doing pretty good though. Thank you, Katie.
Yeah, you're very welcome, Lauren. Thanks for reaching out and asking me to do this. This was a blast.
Of course. So what are some things that people can do, I don't know, if they're at home and they were like, wow, that was really cool, I want to do that again. Ooh. What would be, how do they keep on practicing and stuff?
Yeah, lots of different ways. So if you have some pictures from hikes that you've been on that you're like, wow, I would love to kind of revisit that area, go ahead and pull that picture out, take a look at the paints you have and the picture that you have, and kind of try to translate that picture onto your paper. And again, be gentle with yourself and have fun with it. The more you paint, the better your painting is going to look, basically. If you like having direction like this, there are so many people on YouTube that you can go, I mean, just go on YouTube and type in like watercolor painting demonstration of mountains, of flowers, of trees. That's a great thing to do. Bob Ross is also absolutely wonderful. I think that all of The Joy of Painting is on Netflix. And if not, you can definitely find that on YouTube too.
Cool. Can I take the liberty of having a camera and showing everybody mine?
Ooh, nice job, Lauren.
It ain't so bad, is it?
I love it.
All right, good. I really enjoyed making the canoes. So thanks everyone for joining. It was really great. A lot of good communication back and forth in the chat. And yeah, we really enjoyed having you here. I see that they couldn't see it.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, good. Goodness. Thanks. The camera makes it look kind of big and blobby, but I guess that's what it's all about.
Mm-hmm. Did you add some extra colors in there?
I did. I added a lot of color down there and around there.
Beautiful.
I thought I'd get a little inventive. That's what it's all about. Thank you, Susan. I think it looks great as well. Let me get myself off there. But yeah, that was wonderful. Thanks everyone for joining. We will probably be doing another one. Keep an eye out on the website, on social media. I'll send you all out an email as well. We have your contact information so you can join up and get premier picks for the next event that we do.
Yeah, definitely. Should we stick around a little bit and just see if anybody has questions to answer?
Yeah, we can do that. If anyone's got questions, put them in the box. We'll get back to them.
Yeah. Awesome.
Ooh, a big fish painting. Katie, do you know how to paint fish?
Do I know how to paint fish? I mean, if I had a picture of a fish, I think I could paint them. yeah, but fish aren't what I normally paint. But there are, I'm sure you could find like a watercolor fish tutorial on YouTube if you wanted to.
There you go.
Yeah. Good. I think somebody asked about my backpacking gear. I can grab that for you right now. I don't know who it was, but I saw one flash by.
Oh, yeah, that's a good call.
Oh, Leah, my mom does have the best trail magic.
So everyone, if you're still out there, if there's something particular that you would like to learn or that you'd like to do, then share with us. For the next one, we were thinking about like narrowing down a little bit and focusing on trees or ponds or sunsets, specific stuff like that. So let us know and we can cater to whatever you might be interested in. Really want to take that opportunity. Oh, will there be access to a recording too? We do have this recorded. I haven't totally figured out how we're going to distribute it, but if you would like to see it, then just send us an email and I can figure it out for you. That'd be great. Great.
All right. So the stuff that I brought with me out on the long trail and out on the Appalachian Trail is, actually, I'm going to show you my exact Appalachian Trail kit right now. So first of all, the all-important Ziploc bag to keep everything nice and dry. Ziploc bags are everything. I've got a sketchbook. Let's see. Yes, you can all see that. And these are just some things I was doing on the AT, and it's just this is a watercolor sketchbook. Ooh, and that's stuck together. So it's just got, you know, watercolor paper in it, whereas a lot of other sketchbooks are just kind of regular paper. But since I do watercolors, I like having watercolor paper with me. It's a little bit thicker and it holds up to the water better. So that's that. And this one has like a nice little rubber strap to hold one of the pages down because it's often windy when you're painting outside. So that is the sketchbook. I've got just a smaller version of my watercolor palette. So it's basically the same thing as this, a lot of the same colors in there, but it's just smaller and more transportable. So that's that. Somebody earlier asked about Micron pens. I do actually carry those with me while I'm hiking because it's fun to kind of draw out what I'm doing first and then color it in a little bit. I use Stadler watercolor pens. or pigment liner pens. I just like these. I bought them at the art store once and I was like, yeah, these are cool. So that's what I use. I carry, you know, two or three of those in different sizes. I've got a very tiny mini Nalgene bottle for water. When I was at Stratton Pond, I carried like a little Chobani yogurt cup with me, and you can just scoop that into the pond and use that for water, but any little thing. And then these are a really cool thing. These are actually called water brushes. So it's a paintbrush, but it holds water kind of inside. You can see the little bubble moving back and forth. They hold water inside of them so that you don't need to carry a separate water container. So those are a fun thing to use too. Yeah. And that's basically my backpacking setup.
Cool. That little, the water brush is neat.
Yeah. Yeah. These are super cool. I like them a lot. And basically how you use them is you just like squeeze it and the water comes out through your bristles.
Huh.
You pick up your paint and like, there you go. So those are super fun. Yeah.
Good. All right. Well, I think we've got most people's questions in here, Katie. Again, if you guys have more, then send an email to what I put into the chat box there. I look forward to seeing all your pictures. We'll share them out with you and come to the next one. So thank you so much, Katie.
Yeah, you're very welcome, Lauren. And thanks everybody for coming and painting with me and listening to me ramble for an hour and a half.
I enjoyed one of the questions or one of the chats in there. Thanks for giving us all an opportunity to get lost in nature for an hour. And that's, I think, what this is all about, is just like step back and make a painting. So
yeah, absolutely.
And we look forward to seeing you all out on the trail when the time comes, and maybe sitting down and looking at a pond or at a mountain together sometime. So thanks all.
Definitely.
I'm going to stop recording.